Our Father, we long for the simple beauty of Christmas, for all the old familiar melodies, words, and symbols that remind us of that great miracle when He, who had made all things, came one night as a babe to lie in the embrace of a woman's arm. But in that longing, let us even more yearn for your renewed presence among us, even as we celebrate and expect the coming of your Son. Before such mystery, we kneel as we follow the shepherds and wise men to bring you the gift of our love, a love we confess has not always been as warm or sincere or real as it should have been. Now, as we enter into this Advent season, we pray that love would find its beloved and from you receive the grace to make it pure again, warm and real. We bring you our gratitude for every token of your love, for all the ways you have heaped blessings upon us during the years that have gone. And we do pray, Lord Jesus, that as we begin this four-week journey of expectation and hope, we may do it in a manner well-pleasing to you. May all we do and say, every tribute of our hearts, bring honor to your name, that we, your people, may remember your birth and feel your presence among us even yet. May the loving kindness of this Advent season and the true spirit of Christmas not only slip into our hearts this season, but there abide, so that not even the return to earthly cares and responsibilities, not all the festivities of our own devising, may cause it to slip away weeping. May the joy and spirit of Christmas remain with us now and forever. In the name of Jesus, who came to save his people from their sins, even in that lovely name, we pray.
As we begin this Christian year, we also celebrate the holy season known as Advent. It is a time when we prepare ourselves for the coming of our Messiah. Advent means coming. We celebrate these days of Advent in expectation and preparation for Christ's arrival. Through the centuries, Christians have observed a time of waiting and expectation before the celebrating the birth of the Savior at Christmas. The Advent season is a time of reflection and preparation, but its mood is joyful. Advent has been enriched by Christian tradition to reflect its distinctive Christian meaning. It proclaims the revelation of God's love as expressed in Christ's birth in a humble stable, his sacrificial death on the cross, and his victorious resurrection. It points to the hope of Christ's coming again as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Christ's coming again in this Advent season makes innkeepers out of all of us, asking each of us to make room for the arrival of Christ. Let us tonight prepare room for him in our hearts, our lives, and in our homes.
The candles on the Advent wreath are arranged in a circle to remind us of the continuous power of God, which knows neither beginning nor ending. There is also symbolism in the colors of the candles. The three purple candles symbolize the coming of Christ from the royal line of David. He is coming as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, as well as the Prince of Peace. The pink candle is meant to be lit on the third Sunday of the Advent season. This candle represents joy. The large white candle in the center is known as the Christ candle and points to Jesus as the Christ, the light of the world. A progression is noted in the lighting of the candles of the Advent wreath each Sunday, and with each candle being lit, the Advent wreath glows brighter and brighter. Each candle symbolizes various aspects of our waiting experience: hope, expectation, preparation, joy, and proclamation. The culmination of the season comes as we light the Christ candle on Christmas Day, when we join together as a community of faith to rejoice that the promise of long ago has been fulfilled in the birth of Christ as Emmanuel, God with us.
Thank you.
visual, and performing arts have always been important ways to communicate the Christian faith. The use of music has helped believers understand their godly hope. Other forms of visual art have been used from the beginning to help express various aspects of Christian doctrine and life. The colors used at the altar and on the banners are some of the most important visual ways used to express faith in worship. The communion table with cloths of various colors was to focus the attention of worshipers on the special nature of Christ as the perfect sacrifice. While Christmas has always been celebrated with joy in liturgical churches, Advent has been observed as a penitential season, a preparation as with Lent. Later this month, our altar will be adorned with Christmas poinsettias. This plant is called Flower of the Holy Night. The poinsettia is a many-pointed star that has become a symbol of the Star of Bethlehem and the blood of Christ. At Advent, we wait with anticipation and celebration for our coming Christ. So our hearts sing out, O come, Emmanuel.
Tonight we rededicate the chrismon tree and the ornaments with symbols of Christ for his life, his word, and his resurrection for our salvation. Each of these chrismons, or Christ's monograms, was handmade by members of the chapel. Each was chosen with a scripture in mind to glorify God and offer praises to his Son. Chrismons are traditionally made in combinations of white and gold. White, the liturgical color for Christmas, contains all the colors of the spectrum and reminds us that Jesus brings to us in himself the fullness of what it means to be human. The gold reminds us of his majesty and glory. We use white lights on the tree to remind us that Christ is the light of the world. The baby's breath is used to symbolize the breath of Christ's coming as a child in the manger.
One of the universal features of Christmas is the use of evergreens in churches and homes. Among ancient Romans, evergreens were an emblem of peace, joy, and victory. The early Christians placed them in their windows to indicate that Christ had entered the home. Holly and ivy, along with pine and fir, are called evergreens because they never change color. They are ever green, ever alive, even in the midst of winter. They symbolize the unchanging nature of our God, and they remind us of the everlasting life that is ours through Christ Jesus. Holly became widely used in church celebrations. Holly was considered as the burning bush, or a symbol of Mary, whose being glows with the Holy Spirit. The red berries represented the blood drops from the cruel thorns in the crown of Jesus. In Isaiah chapter 60, verse 13, we find these words: "The glory of Lebanon shall come unto you, the fir tree, the pine tree, and the box together, to beautify the place of your sanctuary." Our forefathers called the procuring of these evergreens bringing home Christmas.
Thank you.
lessons of Christmas. Let us listen to the lessons of the years and the centuries, not just to impressions of the moment, the images of today, and in biblical history are often discouraging. War, hate, famine, epidemics, a Caesar on his throne, a Paul in prison, Christians being persecuted. But now, after the centuries, the Caesar is gone. Paul is a symbol of faith, and Jesus, the truth and the light, is reaching out to every nation. Let us, through the great traditions of our faith, join with the shepherds of Bethlehem, the wise men from the east, and the seekers throughout the ages to welcome the one who came at Christmas. Let us, at Christmastide, bring out our gifts to him. And may the message of our songs be, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill to peoples everywhere.
Thank you.
One of the most heartfelt expressions of Christmas is the Nativity. The Nativity speaks of the mystery of God's wisdom, how the Christ child was born fully human and fully divine is a mystery beyond our human experience and understanding. What we do know is that God reached out to all people, including the poor and the wealthy, the simple and the wise, the powerless and the powerful. All who found him knelt in humility before him. Knowing God is possible because he came to us at our level. Whenever we see a nativity, we find ourselves with Mary and Joseph, with the shepherds, and with the wise men, bowing before the manger, overwhelmed by God's expression of love in coming to us. Soon we will display a nativity on our church grounds for all in the community to see that Christ is the center of Christmas. In our sanctuary, there also are Chrismon symbols of the Nativity and the life of our Savior.
Thank you.
From the beginning of Christmas celebrations, gift giving has been a part of the season. The wise men gave out of their treasures, and the shepherds gave of themselves. Both express the gift of God in giving Christ as the Savior of the world. Unique in our history of generous givers is the story of Saint Nicholas, Bishop of Myra in Lycia in the 4th century AD. He is reputed to have been wealthy, his emblem being 3 purses and 3 golden balls. This was the symbol of rich Italian families of the time. The good bishop gave his money away secretly to those whom he found in need, especially the young people. Gifts coming from unknown sources were commonly attributed to him, and parents customarily gave him credit for their gifts to their children. Here at the village chapel, the rich traditions of gift giving includes our support of children throughout the world in the Operation Christmas Child boxes for Samaritan's Purse. In support of our community, we have sponsored families at poverty level or below through the Angel Tree program, providing food and gifts and spiritual materials. As Jesus said in Acts 20, verse 35, it is more blessed to give than to receive.
The Christ of Christmas. The greatest gift of Christmas is the gift of God in Jesus Christ. All that we do at this holy season points to that expression of holy love. Christ came as a babe in Bethlehem, God's gift at Christmas. As Christians, we seek to pass on our heritage to our children, and to those who, by faith in Christ, become part of the family of God. It is through the work of the Holy Spirit in your life and mine that the gift goes on. In that gift is life, hope, and a future reconciliation between God and all of us who are so often unreconciled in our human relationships. And now, in this penitential season of Advent, let us confess our sins. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on us. Forgive us all our sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen us in all goodness. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep us in eternal life. Amen. And the Almighty God, may he bless us with his grace. Christ, give us the joys of everlasting life. And to the fellowship of the citizens above, may the King of Angels bring us all.